head opens up. Old tree. And chup. We're out. In the very much open jungle here. Mountain jungle. Very nice day. Very nice tree. Gone out. Let's descend again. Into the mossy shadow. Creepers.
The Buddha's speech on friendliness. What should the clever one advantageously do to attain this state called peace is this. He should be intelligent, straight, honest, humble, gentle, and never proud, contented and easy to support, not busy, careful, and silenced. In abilities and senses, cautious and modest. Neither flattering families nor be demanding. Not doing even a minor trifle that other wise men might criticize. Then he should think, may all beings be joyous and safe. Let every creature's mind rejoice, whatever breathing beings there are, no matter whether feeble or firm, with none excepted, whether long, tall, big, medium, short or small, whether seen or unseen, visible or not, whether living far away or near here, whether existing or just about to come into being, let every living being's mind be exultantly jubilant. Let no one ever kill or another being undo, nor ever harm anyone anywhere at all. Let no one wish even a minor bad for another, neither from provocation nor from revenge. Thus, as a mother with her own life might guard her only baby child, thus should he maintain a mentality of infinite friendliness for every living being, in gentle sympathy for this entire universe, unlimited, endless, and waste. As above, so below, and all around, unimpeded, without any hatred, purged of all enmity, whether standing, walking, seated or lying down, while slumbering, he should always maintain such awareness of gentle and benevolent kindness. This very mentality is the divine dwelling here, they say. He that do not traffic with many speculative views, perfected in seeing what is right and wrong, purged of lust for sense pleasures, he will surely not come back here to any womb.
Hello to you, friends. This is an episode of What Buddha Said, mixed sayings. And today, which is a completely silent, very nice day here in the forest, a little bit hot. We climbed into to a crack, a mossy crack full of boulders around here, as you see on the intro, and the exit as well. But first, as usual, the normal intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the best Buddha. The sayings today revolves around the concept, core concept of in Buddhism called Metta, which is basically goodwill, friendliness, kindness, gentleness, harmlessness. And the event that inspired this, there was an incident here where a traffic accident where a mirror was damaged. It ended up with a fight where one man was killed, and then it ended up with a inter-community hostility, which ended up with another youngster being killed, and 50 houses burned down and four religious places ruined because of one mirror, one traffic car mirror, and a minor traffic accident. It blew out of proportion because of this lack of metta. And I think we all know it, that suddenly this animosity, this revengeful feeling, which can suddenly boil up. And, you know, with this flaming sword of righteousness, there has been a mirror that's been damaged. But this is by no means a justification of killing two people, burning down five houses, and ruining four religious places, and causing disharmony on an entire island of 20 million people that was closed down basically for 10 days. So this is lack of this metta, which then boils over into this hate and revengefulness, standing there high up on the barricades of righteousness, and with the flaming sword chopping heads, which makes the case even much worse. Much worse. So let's see what the Buddha have said about it, because usually these sayings seal the deal and make the issue plain and transparent. We can let it sit here. I forgot my microphone in the tree. I think it sits actually fairly well there. Anyway, so goodness galore. This is a mixed saying called. This is from the Anguttara Nikaya, the numerical sayings which you see here, which I can recommend all Buddhists to read. May all creatures, the Buddha said, all breathing beings, all beings, one and all, without any exception, experience good fortune only. May they not fall into any harm. Anguttara Nikaya, number 272. So all beings here mean all breathing things, all beings, one and all, means sabba sattā. Sattā means sentient being. Being that can feel pain, beings that can suffer. Plants here cannot suffer, bacteria cannot suffer, but they are beings. They can propagate, huh? They are alive, but they cannot suffer because they don't have consciousness. So beings here means sentient beings, beings that can feel. Satta. Those who breathe. And this is whether they stay here or there or up or down or are low or high on the 31 levels of existence on this planet or in another universe, divine, human, male, female, of this race, that race, this skin color, that skin color, this orientation, that orientation, whatever, may they be happy. May they not fall into any harm. So it seems at first to be kind of like a naive well-wishing, but it is not. Why not? Because what you wish when you say experience good fortune only, may they not fall into any harm, then it is under the knowledge and comprehension that this is only possible insofar as they themselves, the beings themselves, knows the cause of good, one of which is harmlessness, one of which is practicing this goose will. Only then can they not fall into any harm. So it is more like saying, may they know the causes of happiness, the karmic causes of happiness, because then they will come to experience happiness. May they know the causes of harmlessness, because if they are harmless, then they will not fall into any harm because of this karmic mirror effect. Huh? If you harm, you will be harmed. If you're harmless, you will not be harmed. If you make others happy, you're happy yourself. That's why it's not naive well-wishing. And that's why there is a second level in that saying. I hope it's clear now. Second verse. Train yourself in doing good that lasts and brings happiness. Cultivate generosity, the life of peace, and a mind of infinite universal love. Itivuttaka 22, which you see here. Itivuttaka can mean thus was it said, or it was said like this. Can also be thus was it spoken. It was spoken like this. In doing good, train yourself in doing good. It is to do something that is to the common good, not to the good to the ego. That's egoistic. It should be good for all beings. Then it's good. What is good? The good intention is anything that is not colored, tainted by, mixed by, influenced by either greed, hate, or ignorance. And that is motivated by the opposite of greed, which is generosity, giving, sharing, caring. The opposite of hate, which is goodwill, gentleness, kindness, benevolence, amity, friendliness, first of all. And the opposite of ignorance, which is certainty, knowledge, assuredness, absence of doubt, certainty, wisdom, basically. And a mind of infinite, universal love. A love supreme. We can take up again, huh? It's important, this infinite, because there is an epithet in the Pali language of it, of Metta, is called the Apamanya Brahma Vihara, the infinite divine state. Why is it infinite? Because it is infinite. It doesn't have any border. As soon as you set a border, you say, okay, I love those in my family. This is very common. People, they love their own family, but not others' family. or their own football club, but not others' football club. They have favoritism for this and that. They have bias tendencies, likes, which also means then they have dislikes for anything else that they like. Their family, their culture, their political party, their religious affiliation, and so forth. Huh? But this not metta. There's a border there. You love these guys, huh? But those are on the other side of that border, right on the other side, one atomic length on the other side of that border, then it's hate. It is not us, it is them. Suddenly, huh? But this is not infinite universal love. Infinite universal love loves all sentient beings, and for that matter, also all insentient beings in the entire cosmos that is inherently infinite, that has no limit, no border, no discernible border, at least we can say. So we don't know, but what we can say is that there's no, we cannot put a border on it. We cannot put a finite number of the number of beings in this cosmos. It is infinite. And it is important from a causal point of view, cause and effectiveness point of view, because when you make this goodwill, this friendliness, this gentleness, this love infinite, then the echo effect also will be infinite. If the cause is infinite, the echo also will be infinite. The effect will be infinite. And this means that it will, when one succeeds, and when one succeeds on the pillow, and also moment by moment, momentarily, to make this love, this friendliness, this goodwill, make it really infinite, without any border, endless, boundless, for all beings whatsoever, then it compensates out all evil one have done for a very long time. Because now all these small things one did here and there and there and there, they might be evil, but they were finite. Huh? So if you compensate something, small finite things here up, okay, they stack up and become something. But then you have something that is infinite. It's extremely effective. It's extremely effective in liberating the mind from all resentment, from all opposition, from all anger, irritation, rigidity, stubbornness, wrath, anger, revengefulness, and outright hate. It releases the mind from that. Releases the mind from that. I love supreme. I love supreme. I love supreme. John Coltrane. With goodwill for the entire cosmos, cultivate a limitless heart and mind, beaming above, below, and all around, unobstructed, without trace of hostility. Samahita Nikaya. No, Sutta Nipata I, verse 8. Sutta Nipata, the verse collection, you see it here. Also part of Kutaka Nikaya, the small text collection. With goodwill for the entire cosmos, not this only universe, but all universes, all multiverses there are in this endless, waste, infinite cosmos. Limitless heart and mind. So, in the beginning, it is something intellectual for one. One has it up here, but it should become, one should drag it down and try to make it also emotional. Because when you make it emotional, make it beams it out from your heart towards all heart regions of all beings in the entire universe, above, below, and all around in 10 directions, usually in the front, middle direction, left, back, half direction, right, mid frontal and frontal, above as below, then it is all around. It is all around. So it's directional. So you, one is focusing the beam of influence, of goodwill towards, and it's good to train that. And thereby then also make it waste, infinite in extension and magnitude, reaching everyone, everyone, whoever that might be, not definable, limitless, endless, without trace of ill will. Having killed anger, you sleep in ease. Having killed anger, you do not grieve. The Noble One prays the slaying of anger with its honeyed crest and poisoned root. For having killed it, you do not sorrow. Samahita Nikaya 2:70. So this is the only killing, the Noble One's praise is this killing of hate, killing of anger, killing of irritation, which is says to has this honeyed crest. It's like an arrow. You shoot an arrow, there's honey on the tip. Because that's this expression in English language, the sweet revenge. Huh? The revenge is sweet when you get it, but later down the road, then you have to taste the poison of the karmic effect of this revenge, which is very, very bitter, very, very bitter for a very, very long time. For having killed this anger, you do not sorrow, you do not grieve, you do not experience suffering. There is an episode in the Tipitaka where the Buddha, he comes to a place and speaks to a lot of people, I think more than 500, until long into the night. And then he say to another monk, I think it's Sariputta, can you speak for me because I'm tired in my back, I have to lie down. And then it's told later on that he has to lie down because of this back pain. He has a constant back pain. Why does he have this constant back pain? Yeah, once he told himself that once in the former time, he was a wrestler, professional wrestler, went from marketplace to marketplace and wrestled other people for money and betting. And then he had a competitor, a rival, which has humiliated him in another place. And then he took revenge of him. One day he had him by the neck and bent it down by the legs. And so if he pressed on, he could break his back. And then said, should I break his back or not? And then he decided to break his back. This means that the other wrestler was lame from here and downwards. So he took revenge. And this revenge then followed him for a very long time, existence after existence, universe after universe. And even in his last existence, he will have a constant back pain because of having done this as a young, revengeful wrestler, universal cycles, eons, kalpas ago. So this gives meaning to this sentence that anger, hate, revengefulness has this honeyed crest, honeyed pointed arrow, dart-like thing, but its base is poison, is bitter. So this one should think about. The revenge is not sweet. The revenge is extremely bitter. And this, the expression has just emerged because the observation time is too short. Those who think that the revenge is sweet has not experienced yet and are not realized that they have experienced a karmic downfall because of revenge, because of taking revenge. So the revenge is always bitter, it's always poisoned, and therefore to kill, to slay down, to eradicate this anger, this hate, basically coming from the same root, dosa, If you take hate and dilute it, you get anger. If you dilute anger, then you get irritation. If you get it, dilute irritation, you get opposition. If you dilute that, then you get resentment. If you dilute that, you get stubbornness. But stubbornness, even though it's a very diluted form of hate, it is still hate. It is still hate. So all these things goes away when cultivating this endless, infinite, boundless, cosmic friendliness and love. How to do it? Yes, again, we go back to Goenka and his saying, because one way of doing it is, of course, to be aware of it. And how to be aware in every single moment. You can't be aware in this moment, but then you're so, oh, you're so sweet, love, 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 supreme. And then in the right next moment, you hate somebody else that comes into the scene and ruins the show. Huh? So it doesn't help to know infinite friendliness, metta, if one is not aware of it continuously. When the favorite enemy enters the equation, which they can do from all directions at all time points. Huh? So Goenka, he says like this, if you keep unbroken awareness, breath by breath, in every in-breath and in every out-breath, then the knots of this karma, this creation of future, will be sundered, broken up. The knot will be cut, chop, leading to the highest welfare. Esen Goenka. Breathing in, may all beings be happy. Breathing out, may all beings be happy. Breathing in, a love supreme. Breathing out, a love supreme. One breath is enough to establish this cosmic goodness. Thank you. May many beings, I can hear the beings here, they rejoice. May many beings, if not all beings, become happy by knowing and practicing exactly this infinite, endless, boundless friendliness, goodwill, this cosmic love. Namo. Tassu. Bhagavato. Arahato. Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy. Honorable. And perfectly self-enlightened. Was a blessed Buddha, indeed. Before we close up, I like to remind, first of all, to click subscribe, the small bell and like and all that jazz, but also that there is a meditation course here in June, the 17th to the 30th June. There's still open seats. If you're on the fence about it, then jump down and give me an email and come along, because you're very welcome and you will never, never, ever, ever forget it, nor regret it, because it will go through the entire Buddhism and there will be a lot of praxis also. And yoga morning and evening, vegetarian meals, and one trip to the lotus offering trip to the Temple of the Tooth, And one trip also up here to the forest of the cyber hermitage, and maybe we can take a small jungle tour also. So if you're on the fence, make a decision that will improve your future. Dare I say infinitely? Yes, I do. Certainly so. Infinitely advantage is this meditation course, and others as well. Thank you for your advantageous attention, your clever consideration, and your kind contribution. Not the least, thank you to the food donors. Keep it coming, because every third week I go to Candy and buy a humongous amount of food for 3 weeks. And there is almost, last time there wasn't anything more needed, but usually there is still room for a little bit donation from outside. And it's good to give food, then you get physical health, strength and beauty. Thank you also to the regular donors that makes the wheel turn around, the videos coming. And thank you also to the meditation hall supporters. The project is still growing. We are carrying up sand and are starting on the pillars little by little. Thank you and have a nice day.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution and have a nice day.